July 18th to December 14th. So if you haven't seen it already, I really encourage you to check it out. So first of all, thanks to the DMA and Gabriel Ritter for working with us to help put this on here at SMU, and for Slavs and Tatars for participating. Essentially, the structure for today will be a lecture performance that will last about 40 minutes or so. And then following that, Gabriel Ritter and I will be talking with Slavs and Tatars. And then we're going to open it out to the audience for more of a dialogue. So Slavs and Tatars was founded in 2006. It's an artist collective whose installations, lecture performances, sculptures, and publications contemplate the lesser-known similarities found in the mix of belief systems and rituals among peoples of the Caucasus, Central Asia, and Eastern Europe. Pursuing an unconventional research-based approach, the group identifies the area east of the former Berlin Wall and west of the Great Wall of China, known as Eurasia, as the focus of their multidisciplinary practice. They've exhibited all over the world, but just as a few examples, the recent Berlin Biennial, Manifest of Ten in St. Petersburg, the Guangzhou Biennial, Tate Modern and Salt in Turkey, MoMA in New York, Red Cat in LA, as well as in cities such as Dubai, Warsaw, Vienna, and many, many more. So please join me in welcoming Slavs and Tatars.
Thank you, Noah, and thank you to the Meadows Museum team and the DMA and Gabriel for the opportunity to be here. This afternoon's talk is called Mola Nasruddin, Embrace Your Antithesis, and we had a personal experience with embracing our antithesis a bit earlier that we'll talk about a bit later in the talk. Mola Nasruddin was probably the most important Muslim periodical of the 20th century. It was read from India all the way to Marrakesh, and it was published between 1906 and 1930. Before I get into the periodical itself, I thought I might maybe just give you a little bit of a further sort of intro into who we are. Noah mentioned that we have a very specific geographic remit. Am I reverberating? Can you hear me perfectly? So we have a particular geographic remit between the former Berlin Wall and the Great Wall of China, but we actually started off, and this is where the research sort of comes in, we started off as a publishing practice or as a book club, essentially, sort of halfway between Oprah Winfrey and Attila the Hun. We were basically publishing material that was either not available in English or had been out of print, or translating that material ourselves. This is just some of the six or so publications in the past 6 or 7 years, in addition to Mola Nasruddin. Mola Nasruddin for us has become somewhat of a kind of retroactive mascot. I should tell you who he is. The magazine is named Mola Nasruddin after a kind of 12th, 13th century Sufi wise man come fool. The Sufi wise men come full. They were basically everybody. You find a version of Mola Nasruddin everywhere from Croatia all the way to China and probably down to Sudan and Somalia. Essentially, everywhere there were kind of significant Muslim populations, there's this sort of folk figure, Mola Nasruddin. And he's a kind of precursor to today's equivalent we were just mentioning would probably be Ali G or Borat in a sense. He sort of asks very stupid questions, a very serious subject matter. And children are raised on stories of Mola Nasruddin, almost like the kind of Brothers Grimm or La Fontaine's fable, for example. Typical Mola Nasruddin story would be Mola Nasruddin is on one side of the river, and somebody's on the other side of the river and yelling to Mola Nasruddin, "Mola Nasruddin, how do I get to the other side of the river?" And he says, "You are on the other side of the river." So using kind of very, very first degree humor, but unpacking sort of questions, larger, more complex questions of identity, relativism, morality, ethics, and so on and so forth. He's often depicted a figure riding backwards on his donkey. And for us, he's become a kind of retroactive mascot. And what I mean by that is that we've kind of taken him to be kind of a figure of what we call the anti-modern, Obviously, we're not against modernity. Being anti-modern doesn't mean being against modernity. We're sitting here talking on a MacBook Pro using all this sophisticated technology. But what we use the term in the way that the French professor at Columbia University and at the Collège de France, Antoine Compagnon, he wrote a book called Les Antimodernes, and he basically traced it in 19th century French literature from Peggy and Chateaubriand all the way to, in fact, to the 20th century, to Barthes through Baudelaire. And he basically says the real modernists are not people like Mayakovsky, whose drawings we've reworked in the Carpet series that you'll see at the DMA, or people like Marinetti, not these kind of utopianists who are sort of running towards the future, but the real modernists, he argues, are those figures who had a kind of conflictual relationship with the passing of the pre-modern age. So basically, people who are not so sure that modernity would bring all the promises or deliver all the promises that it was supposed to. And in fact, you see this kind of trope. For example, Sartre describes Baudelaire as driving into the future, but with an eye on the rearview mirror. Or Mola Nasreddin is often depicted backwards on his donkey because he's essentially walking into the future, but facing the past. And you also see it, of course, in Walter Benjamin's Angel of History, who's being propelled into the future, but facing the kind of the rubble of the present and the past. And interestingly enough, we were in Madagascar about 5 years ago, and the Malagash language of Madagascar, the words used to describe the past and the future, they spatially show how our, let's say, Indo-European languages are positivist vis-a-vis time, meaning that when you and I talk about the past or the future, whether it's in French or in Russian or in English or in German, we describe the past as behind us and we describe the future as in front of us because we assume we know where we're going. Now, if anything, the financial crisis of 2008 proved that to be wrong, but also I think it's more wise in a sense to use the Malagash approach. Madagascar, the words they use to describe the future is the future is behind you and the past is in front of you. So in fact, you're looking at the past as you're sort of moving towards the future. Now, the ability to bring together in sort of one space, one page, one voice, two ends of the spectrum that you don't normally put together, that you wouldn't see in sort of one space, one page, or one voice, or two ends of the spectrum that are considered to be antithetical or incommensurate, that's become somewhat of a kind of a modus operandi for us, Slavs and Tatars. We've attempted to do so via our very mission statement, as Noah mentioned, between the former Berlin Wall and the Great Wall of China. These are not normally walls that you put together in the same kind of phrase, but also between the two great geopolitical narratives that these two walls encompass of the 20th and 21st centuries, being that of communism of the 20th century and political Islam of the 21st century. In English, there's a lot of different words for this kind of bringing together these two ends of the spectrum. Half of them are not actually English, probably Latin still, like coincidentia oppositorum. You've heard of cognitive dissonance. Amphiboly means expressing two contradictory phrases in one phrase. We like to say that we kind of call it the metaphysical splits, meaning that you're doing the splits not of the legs, but of the mind, sort of trying to wrap your mind around two things that you don't normally wrap your mind around. And an early work, I think, that's very indicative of this is a piece called, this is a vacuum form piece called Dig the Booty. I don't need to translate this for most of you because you're English speakers, but in other parts of the world, it's a fun trying to translate this, of course, or interpret this. But essentially, it's an aphorism that says, dig the booty of monoglots, but marry my child a polyglot. Meaning that if you're going to have a one-night stand and sort of fool around, do so with somebody who speaks one language. But if you're going to settle down and get serious, better do so with somebody who speaks more than one language. Now, this aphorism, normally, as you'll probably agree, in English, people who use the words dig the booty, it's a different register of language. They don't end the sentence with polyglot and monoglot, because dig the booty is of the street, let's say. Polyglot and monoglot is of the academy. But also, as you'll see here, this will be the subject matter of the exhibition at the DMA to a certain extent, but also the talk and lecture that we'll do in October 18th when we're back, called The Tranny Tease, is this notion of transliteration. This is not translated above. It's actually transliterated. So for those of you who can read Cyrillic or Arabic script, it says the exact same thing. It says, dig da booty of monoglots, but marry my child a polyglot. Transliteration is kind of the lesser man's translation. It's kind of the trashier sibling to translation, right? Translation is something that departments are dedicated to, that scholars, that writers like Nabokov and Edgar Allan Poe dedicate their work to, but transliteration is something that we do on a transactional basis every day if we speak a non-Latin-based language. Another example, I guess, of this metaphysical splits is an exhibition we did at the Secession, where it's called Not Moscow, Not Mecca. Essentially, we normally people don't put Marx and Mohammed in the same phrase or in the same sort of space. People associate Marx with being the darling of the left, and if anything, they associate Mohammed as being the kind of the poster child of the right, or not the right in America, but a kind of conservatism or reactionarism, fundamentalism. And we try to kind of understand it, and we're not the first ones to do so. Of course, Olivier Roy, even Norman Brown, a professor of comparative literature at Santa Cruz, he also was the first to kind of put these two things together. He called Marxism and Islam two types of social criticism alive in the world, and he called them two still revolutionary forces, two tired old horses, neither of them doing very well, but it would be a mistake to take any comfort from their failure. The human race is at stake, and they both, Marxism and Islam, agree on one proposition: there will be one world or there shall be none. And so Norman Brown, the last 10 years of his life, he was a scholar of Blake and William Blake and psychoanalysis, and he devoted the last 10 years of his life to reading the Quran through James Joyce. So and he identifies in Finnegan's Wake of James Joyce 110 of the 114 surahs of the Quran. Of course, you could argue that you can find anything you want in James Joyce's Finnegan's Wake if you try hard enough, I'm sure. But it's interesting nonetheless. So Mawlana Nasruddin, the periodical itself, was a political satire that ran about 8 to 12 pages each issue, and it was published between 1906 and 1930. And as I mentioned, it was read across the Muslim world from India to Morocco. What's remarkable about that is that it was the reason why it was able to be read across such a large swath of the world and amongst people who speak very different languages: Arabic, Turkic, Persian, Urdu, or others, is because it was the majority of the magazine was actually caricatures or illustrations. So it was a kind of satire, a kind of mad magazine of the early 20th century. And it was instrumental to a sense of Azeri political, Azeri identity, but it was also very progressive. It was kind of for women's rights, against the double standard of women, applied to Muslim women and Christian women, against corruption and sort of colonialism, and it was also just very funny and extremely well illustrated. So this is a kind of typical Mawlana Nasruddin illustration. It was published in Baku, which is the capital of present-day Azerbaijan. But here you have, for example, the Russian Imperial Army ushering in sort of Azeris into the mosque, saying, go to the mosque, it's Sunday, it's the day of prayers. Of course, Sunday is not the day of prayers. For Muslims, it's Fridays, but it didn't matter to the Tsarist officials. And here you have kind of typical misunderstandings of how the Muslim women are, the Azeri women are horrified by the Europeans, and the Europeans are horrified by the Muslims, this kind of mutual misunderstanding that one would find in the early 20th century Caucasus. Now, as I mentioned, this is Mawlana Nasruddin, the folk figure. There's a great volume that I recommend if you want to know more about Mawlana Nasruddin, written by the Indian author Idris Shah, who compiled the Mawlana Nasruddin stories, the original stories. And here you have him again riding backwards on his donkey. Now, the Caucasus is basically a case study of complexity in the sense of linguistically, but also ethnically. You have over 50 different languages, and often different language groups. So not only sort of just languages within Indo-European family, but sometimes languages which are outside of the Indo-European family. And it was also the site of the great game of the 19th century between Russia and England. And today, between a greater game, I would argue, between not only Russia and the United States, but also China, Turkey, and Iran, sort of all have their hands in the pies of the Caucasus. It's a lot of people sort of wonder why we're so interested in this region. Sort of, we have a kind of enthusiasm for Baku that most people have for sort of Justin Bieber and so. But the fact is that Baku and this region is not as obscure as as the 20th century would have you believe. I would argue that this region has probably been at the center of world history for most of the past 2,000 years. It's actually the last century which was the exception. Just to give you some examples, not only do you have the Silk Route and the Great Game, but Baku was the producer of half of the world's oil until the Second World War. So until oil was discovered in the Middle East, the Caucasus and Baku was the provider of most of the world's oil, which is why the Nazi army was so keen on capturing Baku, because it would shut down the Soviet artillery machine. It's also the subject matter, this complex linguistic complexity, is the subject matter of our first cycle of work and publication called Kidnapping Mountains. Now, the Caucasus is also described as kind of warm Siberia. It was a place that the Russians would send all the riffraff, or the politically thorny people, revolutionaries, narodniks, writers like Lermontov, even Pushkin, anybody who was kind of somewhat a thorn in the side of the imperial czars, they would send. If they didn't send you to Siberia, they sent you to the Caucasus. And after the Tsar's decree of 1905, it became a space of relative press freedom, because the Tsar sort of liberalized a bit before the Russian Revolution. And it's also a place where Griboyedov's Woe from Wit, kind of a favorite playwright of ours, published his writing. Now, this publication, there's quite a lot of precedents of political satires written in the 20th century, early 20th century. There's an anarchist magazine, very famous kind of anarchist magazine called L'Assiette au Beurre, that was by a series of illustrators like František Kupka, Charles Leandre in the early 20th century Paris. You also had publications like Krokodil in the early sort of, throughout the actually mid-20th century in the Soviet Union. Satire was always a very apt form of criticism, because you couldn't, Noah and I were talking about this earlier, you couldn't criticize frontally the regime, so through satire, through metaphor, through allegory, like Mola Nasruddin, you would be allowed to have sort of more serious sort of criticism of governing policies. Now, like the best satires, Mola Nasruddin spoke truth to power and managed to express openly what many people only kind of would keep would hitherto expressed in secret. Here you have Muhammad Ali Shah, the last Qajar king, Shah of Iran, in fact in Odessa in exile. And it was it also had a very clear agenda. An agenda is kind of media as advocacy that we see less and less in our kind of splintered media world of the early 21st century. Now, as I mentioned, the publication was read from Morocco to India, but it was particularly in Iran that it had its greatest influence. Because Azerbaijan, as we can sort of go back into the map, just to give you a sense, Azerbaijan is actually split between Iran and Azeris are split between Iran and Azerbaijan itself. So this is called Soviet Azerbaijan, but this entire region is Iranian Azerbaijan. And Iran is a state, a province called Western and Eastern Azerbaijan that is independent. And it's basically, it's not a porous border, but it's a fluid sense of identity. Azeris don't really distinguish, except the fact that some had to learn Persian in school and others had to learn Russian, but the mother language remains Azeri amongst these, which explains why the publication was so important in Iran, because it was simply across the border that it had to travel. And it, in fact, was what led to one of the most important periodicals of the early 20th century Iran, called Sur-e Israfil, which led to the Iranian Constitutional Revolution. Now, the magazine started out actually in Tbilisi, which is the capital of present-day Georgia, and the reason for that is that Tbilisi was at the time was the capital of what was called Transcaucasia. None of these countries, of course, existed as entities until briefly, like for 3 or 4 years in the early 20th century, and then they didn't exist as independent republics until 1991. Tbilisi, the capital of present-day Georgia, had more Azeris and Armenians living in it than Georgians itself. And this is just some examples of kind of maybe landmark architecture in Tbilisi. Those of you who are familiar with sort of Rem Koolhaas's architecture in Singapore, he's almost sort of cut and pasted these, and Herzog and de Meuron's Vitra Museum outside of Basel as well is very much inspired by this Ministry of Transport in Tbilisi itself. And it was in Baku that it sort of had its longest run. Baku, again, being the capital of Azerbaijan today, And again, it's an iconic example. This is the kind of architecture that you only find in the former Soviet sphere, kind of a mashup of Stalinist, classical, and sort of Ottoman architecture. Just to give you a sense of scale, that's a Mercedes on the front there. And in a sense, it defined its sort of decade in its city and its region in the same way that magazines in the early 21st century defined their sort of cultural zeitgeist. For those of you who are sort of old enough to remember certain magazines like Colors that really defined the moment in the 90s from Milan, or The Face, that how it defined sort of cool Britannia in London in the early 90s and sort of late 90s, or magazines like Purple in Paris, 032C in Berlin. And this was kind of an equivalent for the Caucasus of the early 20th century. Now, it often takes two to tango, as we know with the Beatles, or sort of De Niro and Pacino here. It was similarly with Mola Nasreddin, except maybe less, a bit more obscure figures. The editors Jalil Mamagulzadeh and Alek Ber Sabir were the editor and kind of chief polemicist. Alek Ber Sabir on the right, he was kind of like an H.L. Mencken figure, a kind of pamphleteer polemicist who had to go under 50 different pseudonyms because what he wrote was so sort of strident and critical and was often under attack. These figures were highly influenced by a movement called Jadidism. Jadidism was a reform movement in the early 20th century, late 19th century, of the Russian Empire amongst the Muslims who wanted to reform Islam from within. So what they wanted to do was introduce basically education reforms. So stop teaching in Arabic, start teaching in local languages, publishing textbooks, sort of bring in educational methods that would allow a kind of a moderate modernizing influence. And part of these influences was the idea of Latinizing the alphabet, again, which is an important issue addressed in the exhibition at the DMA. Latinizing the alphabet was a way to kind of westernize or modernize the peoples of the former sort of Muslim peoples of the Soviet Union at the time. Now, what we did to publish this book is we essentially went through about 2,500 illustrations and chose 200 of the best or most relevant illustrations. The books, the volumes that I showed you in the beginning, these have been reissued in the past 10 years in Azerbaijan, and we essentially chose the most relevant in a compilation of 250 or so. And we divided them into chapters. These chapters didn't exist in the beginning. I'm going to focus just on three chapters: women, East versus West, and Iran, for various reasons, as we'll see. As I mentioned, it was a very kind of progressive publication vis-a-vis women's rights. Here you have women, Azeri women, pointing to a prison and saying, look, at least they have windows, because of course the women's quarters of Azeri households didn't even have windows to look out of. So it's this kind of caustic critique of gender politics. And you wouldn't expect Azerbaijan, a kind of a Muslim country, to be a hotbed of, I wouldn't say feminism, but sort of equal rights, let's say. And again, this is why this publication interests us. It kind of reverses our expectations. Azerbaijan gave women the right to vote significantly before the United States, the UK, France, or most countries in Europe. So in 1918, women had the right to vote in Azerbaijan already, which is about 40 years ahead of Switzerland, but that's not much to do. Switzerland is not exactly an arbiter of this. This false sense of pride and respect paid at the beginning of a marriage ceremony at the top, and of course 1 month later, it's all sort of disappeared. And one of my favorite ones was this, is using the Japan as a kind of model of progress and technological advancement. It's important to remember, in 1905, the Russians lost a war to Japan, and it was a kind of a devastating war. It was the enormous Russian Empire losing a battle, primarily navy battle, to a small island nation, and that was a real kind of it really drove the point home of how far behind Russia was and how far ahead Japan was. Here you have a mullah and a kind of a cleric pointing to a Japanese woman and saying, "Dear lady, regardless how much progress your society has made, as long as your face is not covered, you can't compare it with our women." So he's kind of poking fun at the worldview of the cleric itself. This also is a kind of a painfully funny one, but it's a child, and this shows how the power dynamics were reversed when women's rights are not granted, the child blackmailing his mother, saying, if you don't give me candy, I'll tell Papa that you looked out the window. So the child essentially is wielding power over his mother. And here, again, sort of pointing at the double standard, the hypocrisy of the Turkish constitutional reforms. Everybody's sort of clamoring for freedom and reforms, but as soon as they see that it gives women the right to assemble, they say, no, we don't need these reforms. Actually, let's undo these reforms on the bottom. And what was also very interesting is that the magazine used Armenians and Jews, Christians and Jews, essentially, as a kind of counterpoint to Azeri society, and sort of showing how much further advanced the editors considered both Jewish Jews of the Caucasus, because there was a significant Jewish population. If you've read or heard of the New York Times bestseller, The Orientalist, by Tom Rice, talks about one of these families. And here you have a 12-year-old Jewish girl going to school, and the 12-year-old Muslim girl being married off to kind of a salivating old man on the left. And here again, an Azeri man with his wife, Azeri, a Muslim woman, and the same man being sort of whipped by his Russian lover. So this kind of, again, this double standard vis-a-vis Christian and Muslim women. Now, what really kind of first enchanted us about this publication was the alphabet itself and alphabet changes. And that's how we first became interested in the alphabet politics that we've explored further for this exhibition at the concentrations exhibition at the DMA. One of the revolutionary elements of this magazine was that this periodical was that it was published in Azeri. Now, Azeri wasn't considered a literary language at the early 20th century. It was considered to be a dialect. Everybody else at the time would either publish in Istanbul Turkish or Russian. And there's, of course, that great quote that the difference between a dialect and a language is an army and navy. And in this case, you have the parliamentarians, the Russian parliamentarians, cutting out the Azeri tongue and sewing a Russian tongue to an Azeri man. And here are the students sort of asking why they need to replace their Azeri tongue with a Russian tongue. So they're asking their teacher. Now, the alphabet changes of the 20th century have brought sort of devastating havoc onto the cultures of the region, because it's not just in Azerbaijan, but all the Muslim peoples of the Soviet Union, so all the Turkic-speaking peoples. And actually, just for those of you who are not familiar, essentially, Turkic languages are the languages that are Altaic Mongol-based language, so Turkish being the most famous. But most of the Muslim peoples of the Soviet Union speak a Turkic language, whether they're Dagestani, Kazakh, Turkmen, Uzbek, almost everybody except kind of the Tajiks, who speak Persian, and a few pockets of Muslims in the Caucasus. Now, Lenin believed the revolution of the East would Latinize the alphabets of all these Muslim subjects. In fact, it was Trotsky's idea originally, but it was Lenin who advocated it, and he didn't live to see it happen. Stalin did it in 1929. He asked everybody, all the Muslim subjects of the Soviet Union, to bring out their books, burn them, and start reading the same language, but instead of right to left to right in Latin. This is around the same time, of course, as Ataturk doing the same thing in Turkey. But in the interim, 1939, 10 years later, Stalin was deathly afraid of pan-Turkism, of all these Turkic subjects somehow uniting amongst themselves or uniting with Turkey itself, because of course Turkey was a historical enemy of the Russian Empire. And so he asked again, bring out all your books, burn them again, and we're going to read from left to right, but this time in Cyrillic. And then 1991, when they gained independence and the Soviet Union fell, most of them went back, almost all of them went back to Latin. So what you have is this very kind of perverse situation where you have three generations within a language or within a country who can speak the same language but can't read the same book. So a grandmother, a son, and a grandson can speak the same language but can't actually read the same book. So you essentially become immigrants within your own country or within your own sort of cultural heritage. And that was the basis of an early poster of ours that says sort of, instead of fool me once, shame on you, fool me twice, shame on me, fool me once, shame on Arabic, fool me twice, shame on Cyrillic, fool me thrice, shame on Latin. And we thought that we should just rename the Azeri language because it's such a head case of a language, just sort of call it Azeri because it was driving us crazy. It's easy to find a translator from any given language to another language, relatively easy, I should say. But it's very difficult to find a translator who speaks, reads and writes three iterations of that language and the destination language. We essentially couldn't find it. So what we had to do is we had to translate from Azeri to Russian, and we had somebody translate from Azeri to Russian, and we ourselves translated from Russian to English. So it's a little bit mediated. Here you see the three scripts all in one page. So you kind of see this kind of schizophrenia. You have Latin here, Mol and Nasruddin written in Cyrillic in the middle, and then Mol and Nasruddin written in Arabic on the very same page. The caption here again is sort of poking fun at sort of traditional Islamic medicine. And it's the doctor's giving a sick man medicine. He says, if you drink it every 100 years, you'll be fine. Of course. Now, East versus West, this is a bit more complex because this magazine, the editor saw Westernization as progress. So they saw the West as a kind of a fount of education, technology, gender equality. But at the same time, they were against not only superstition and clericalism, but they were against the colonial powers themselves. So they were not exactly pro-Western, but they, as a document of its time, they believed that to be modern, you had to be Western. So here you have, for example, the world according to the devil, which basically saying kind of, it's all very, very, very technologically advanced, and the world according to the book, meaning the Quran, on the right, is kind of a fairy tale world. Now, again, also kind of a black and white comparison of a blimp on the right, and the kind of closest thing to a blimp is Muhammad Ali Shah, the last Qajar Shah, sort of being sent off to Odessa. Or a doctor coming to see a sick woman, and the woman sort of covers her face and doesn't want to allow herself to be sort of revealed to the doctor out of discretion, and the husband sort of beseeching her to show her face and show her throat. But as soon as a cleric comes, she's happy to kind of bare her chest and have a prayer written on her tummy. So it was very kind of stridently against what it considered to be the kind of the passivity or the backwardness of Islam. I mentioned Jadidism, but then we'll just quickly go over. This is actually one of the leading Jadidist thinkers, a Tatar man named Ismail Bey Gasprinsky, who also was a publisher of a periodical called Tarjuman, meaning the translator. And here he's being sort of being given a shout out in the pages of Mullah Nasruddin itself. And I mentioned you have the first day of school in an Armenian school and a Christian school, very busy, and the first day of school in a Muslim school, kind of sleepy, nobody's going to school. The kind of parents are not sending their children to school. And you can see that by another illustration here, a father saying, son, no need to go to school today. I'll just basically finding any excuse to not send their children to school. Now, this hypocrisy, of course, is driven through in a very kind of a sometimes quite a comical sense. Here you have a man who's just performed his pilgrimage, the Hajj, sort of barely peeking at a woman, after a week sort of peeking through his hands, and after a month he's gone to a cleric to get a sire, which is a temporary marriage license, which essentially you can get in Iran today even, which allows you to sleep with a woman out of marriage legally. So basically showing this kind of how long his piety has lasted, essentially a month after coming back from Mecca. Or again, a father sort of pulling his son out of school. Many of the schools in the early 20th century were funded by Christian charities. And he says, "There's, you know, over my dead body will I let you go to a school financed by the infidels." Now, it was anti-colonialist. Here you can see the British with India, the French with Algeria, and the Germans with Zanzibar as sort of flies being sort of kept under cover. And interestingly enough, it often used animals for a kind of an allegory of countries. Now, I'm sure you can guess the tiger is Germany, stands in for Germany. Lion, of course, England. And the foxes here in the front are France and Spain. They're surrounding Morocco as a lamb, sort of all coming in for the kill. Now, what's interesting is that the publication never marked the bear, right? And I'm sure you can guess why, because the bear stands for Russia. And the publication was an official publication. It wasn't an underground publication, it wasn't a samizdat, it was actually a licensed publication. So to get around the censors, it had to kind of leave that up for interpretation. But everybody, of course, understood what the bear meant and who the bear sort of stands for. Here you have, this is also one of my kind of preferred ones, favorite ones. You have the dogs, which are representing the Greeks, and they're barking at Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. And he asks the dogs, why are you barking? And the dogs say, because we'd like to scare the Turks. And he says, well, then why are your tails wagging? And the dogs say, because we're frightened ourselves. So this use of animals also was for very, for either for it sort of I think it also calls forth the kind of the strong role of folktale tradition in Slavic countries and in Eastern Europe and the Caucasus, that through folktales and especially through animal folktales, you also had sort of lessons imparted, much like Mola Nasreddin itself. As I mentioned, this the publication is probably the most important achievement of the last 100 years of the Azeri peoples, far more important than the Zaha Hadid building, which has just gone up, I would say. And it was key to kind of formulating a sense of Azeri identity, as opposed to Russian or, again, Istanbul Turkish. Azeri language is the closest to Istanbul Turkish, but the fact that it was published in the language was a big deal. But this didn't sort of keep the editors from poking fun at the Azeris themselves. So here you have a kind of today sort of mixing and matching sort of haute couture and label sort of brands with sort of streetwear is okay, but at the time it was not considered kind of in any way fashionable. So he's kind of here, they're poking fun at this kind of traditional headwear with this kind of European outfit sort of coming across almost like Frankensteinish. And the Mola Nasreddin himself, I should mention, is the old guy, kind of the Vanna White, presenting the illustrations in many of these covers. And here we have, now, for those of you familiar with the Caucasus and essentially the conflict between Azeris and Armenians, essentially Azeris and Armenians sort of, this enmity goes back about, let's say, 120 years. And it's essentially over a frozen conflict. Today we see a frozen conflict in eastern Ukraine. One of the earliest sort of frozen conflicts is this area called Nagorno-Karabakh, which both nations lay claim to. Now, again, it was a revolutionary gesture for an Azeri publication to use, quote unquote, the enemy, the Armenians, as a kind of model. So a lot of times it would show that Armenians had a sense of solidarity amongst the peoples. The fact is, and even today, if you go to Armenia, Armenians amongst each other speak Armenian. Azeris amongst each other still speak Russian, educated Azeris. And this is a kind of, this is something that the magazine poked fun at, this emphasis on education. Now, I lived for several years in Moscow, for about 4 years in Moscow, and whenever I came across an Azeri, I would always get the question, sort of, Azerbaijan is a majority Shia country. It's probably the only other country that's so overwhelmingly Shia, except for Bahrain and Iran. It's about 97% Shia. And the Azeris sort of would lay it into me, saying, Payam, you're an Iranian. Why are you not supporting us, your Shia brothers? Why are you supporting the Armenians? And this is an aside that shows that it shows the complexity, not only the situation, but it lays, it reveals how this question of kind of a, basically it shows that the Iranian regime is not an apocalyptic messianic regime in any sense, because the reason why Iran supports Armenia, if it were a kind of a messianic Shia crescent, then it would be supporting the Azeris. It doesn't support Azeris because behind Azerbaijan is Turkey, behind Turkey is the United States, and behind Armenia is Russia, and so Iran is aligned with two Christian nations that again sort of belie this notion of Muslims sort of supporting Muslims or Shia supporting Shias. It's obviously a case of real politics. Also, I just love this illustration of Putin washing Ahmadinejad's leg because it's quite classic. Now, here again, you have the Armenians, the Azeris, who are kind of wealthy Azeris who are not supporting their poor brethren, unlike the Armenians who would do so. Or on the right-hand side, you have an Armenian kind of reading room full of sort of debate and discourse. On the left, and what's called a Muslim reading room, and Muslim was a stand-in for Azeri at the time because they were the only large Muslim peoples of the Caucasus, let's say. Now, the reason why the publication had such a strong influence in Iran is because 30% of Iran is, again, we think of Iran as a monolithic nation too often in the news it's presented, but Iran is a very ethnically diverse place. It's 30% of the population is not even Persian, or not Fars, but Azeri Turkish. And it had the largest readership here. So also historically, Iran, the most progressive elements of Iran's history, even the kind of the green movement associated with Mousavi, the candidate who was sort of sidelined, he was from, of course, the Azeri region. And also the establishment of the Persian Constitutional Revolution in 1906, 1910, it was the first time there was an elected parliament in Asia in 1906 in Iran, that was very influenced by this publication, Mullah Nasruddin. Now, you would think that a magazine that had such a large readership would sort of cater to its readers, but Mullah Nasruddin was really anti-Iran. And it's quite interesting that yet the readership sort of lapped it up so much. Here you have the Russian army sort of being held as an example of a kind of an orderly army. And the Iranian army, of course, I don't know if you're familiar with this Muharram ceremonies where Shias kind of self-flagellate. It's making fun of the Iranians, saying that they don't need an enemy. They're essentially injuring themselves with their qameh on their foreheads, sort of spilling their own blood. And of course, Mullah Nasruddin sort of pointing to the veil and saying, this is what we get from Iran. Or sort of swatting away flies, and even more sort of acerbic are mullahs that are essentially portrayed as wolves that put on masks on the right side. And here you have the powers that be. Iran was divided among spheres of influence, the north belonging to Russia, not belonging, but under Russia's influence, and the south, the British influence. And here you have the British, the Russians sort of eating some polo, some rice, Iranian rice, and sort of beckoning to the Turks to come on in and join them before it gets too cold. Now, I mentioned that the publication is a officially sanctioned publication, but that doesn't mean it didn't run into the censors. And periodically, you'll see a kind of a page just marked, very dramatic gesture of ink that looks like blood, saying sort of this page has been censored, which itself was quite a brave act, right? It wasn't in any way trying to gloss over this fact. And inside the pages of the magazine, you had this kind of meta critique. You had an illustration showing 5 years ago, the author, the writer, sort of bullying the censors, and how much changed over the course of the publication's duration, the writer is now being sort of bullied by the censor itself. Now we as Slavs and Tatars had to self-censor when we published this magazine. Why? Well, for various reasons, which is why the publication is, why this talk is called Embrace Your Antithesis. One of the reasons was that it was, for example, these pro-Armenian and anti-Azeri illustrations, we included many of them in the publication, but some of them we just didn't include because we wanted the publication to be widely read in the Caucasus itself. And we knew that if we included too many, it simply would sort of, it would make it a kind of a typical lightning rod whereby Azeris themselves wouldn't have access to their own publication. Also, I mean, for example, here you have a philanthropist. On the top is you have it starts from the right to left. Adar in the beginning, you have an Azeri philanthropist kind of being very large, generous, and giving all his money in the beginning, less in the middle, and by the end he's sort of so angry that he kind of kicks people out. And the Armenian sort of being much more sustainable, one by one, and building it up until sort of it has a more accountable model. Now, this idea of embracing your antithesis is something which we'll hopefully discuss maybe a little bit during the panel discussion. But when we started to do this publication, because of the difficulties in finding a translator, that it took us about 2 years to do this publication, to translate this publication. But it took us about a year to really figure out exactly what the publication is about, because we could figure out some of it, but we couldn't figure out all of it because with our access to Persian or to Russian, we didn't understand exactly what sort of the nuances of some of the illustrations. And in fact, the publication we were afraid would play into the hands of Islamophobes, for example, people who are just sort of waiting for a perfect example, like anybody sort of on the right of the spectrum saying, oh, look, the Muslims themselves are criticizing Islam. So this is we didn't want to give more fuel to that fire. And in some sense, this publication stands against those things we stand for. Not, of course, not women's rights and not this kind of progressive ideas, but we don't particularly believe that modernization has to be westernized. This publication did. And so when we founded Slavs and Tatars, we founded Slavs and Tatars in a way against some of the very founding principles of this publication. And so at some point, Kasha and myself, we had to think about, do we proceed with this publication? I would argue that most of the time, at least in the art milieu, not in academia, but in the art milieu, people don't devote 2 years of their lives to publications they don't believe in. Usually it's usually about sort of restoring or celebrating something which has been overlooked that you believe in. And this is a publication we don't particularly agree with, and yet we continue to publish it because not only is it an important historical document, but also it's only in engaging with those things you disagree with that you really have a sense of true sort of evolution of or knowledge or kind of arc of wisdom in a sense. And I think in our current kind of media climate, you know, if you're on the left of the spectrum, you read The Nation. If you're on the right, you read the Wall Street Journal. If you're in France, you read, Libération. If you're on the right, you read Figaro. If you're in Britain, you read The Guardian. On the right, you read The Daily Telegraph. Google knows what we like. It pushes content towards us. So I don't have to say this to people in the United States, but, you know, we're an increasingly partisan readership, not just politics, but sort of culturally in a worldview as well. And this idea of engaging with those things we disagree with has been quite important for us. I think it's actually something that in sort of Sufism and in Islam, the idea of expatriation is very important. This idea that you have to go as far away from yourself as possible to understand things about yourself. So contrary to this kind of psychoanalytic, very Western emphasis on the individual, sort of you need to understand who you are, what your needs are. It's actually only in sort of, for example, Norman Brown, he became further Presbyterian by actually studying Islam. Or Louis Massignon became more a kind of refound his Christian identity by devoting his whole life to translating and interpreting Halaj, a Sufi saint. And we continued working with Mola Nasruddin, of course. I use this idea of yogurt, which is a kind of an analogy for our work. Not only is yogurt important to our region, but to make yogurt, you have to take yogurt, right? From one bacteria, you make other bacteria. And Mola Nasruddin is a perfect example of this. Mola Nasruddin started out, in that book I showed in the beginning of Kidnapping Mountains of the Caucasus, Mola Nasruddin started out as a double-page spread in our first book on the top here. Then it expanded, like yogurt, bacteria of yogurt, into a whole publication of 200 pages. And from that publication, in the very first lines of the introduction, we talk about the fact that we discovered this in an old bookshop in Baku, and we looked at the publication, and it, like an improbable beauty, winked back at us. And that led to another piece, which is actually a copy of Mola Nasruddin, which essentially winks back at you. In a sort of very deliberately kitsch manner. It also led to a piece for the Gwangju Biennial that Noah mentioned is again, all across the world, the kind of the playground toys or the toys outside of grocery stores that you put a quarter in, they're often like, you're in Poland or you're in Turkey, it's a cowboy and Indians. Well, arguably, cowboys and Indians have nothing to do with Turkey or Poland. So what we'd like to do is sort of, in a sense, celebrate or restore certain folk heroes back to where they should be, sort of certain superheroes. And the Korean children, of course, loved the Mola Nasruddin. It's also something very... we didn't think about this, of course, but there is something strangely perverse about an old man sort of backwards on a donkey, because normally a child holds somebody from behind. And the interesting thing is how do you convey such difficult, such complex matters as anti-modernism, positivism and time, et cetera, to children? And for us, it's always the biggest challenge is sort of our favorite audiences are people under the age of 10 and over the age of 60. I mean, over the age of 60, of course, it's much easier to kind of talk about these issues. But how do you convey these things to a child? Well, the first thing the child usually does when he gets on this Mola Nasruddin is he asks his parents or her parents, why is the old man backwards? So this kind of conversation starter immediately kind of sparks questions of, again, your relationship to time, to progress, to history, and so on and so forth. That's it. Thank you for coming and your patience. And well, I guess continue the discussion later.
Okay, so thank you, Payam. That was great. And one of the first things that I was wondering was this was described as a lecture performance, what we just heard. And I'm wondering what your thoughts on what is a lecture performance? Like, how is it different than a regular lecture? Or, you know, how do you think of that as something that's separate, as something that's talking about something versus maybe being something?
And also, how did you come to this format? Because even calling it a lecture performance, I know audience-wise, I think people aren't sure what they're going to get, like what's in store.
It's a fair question. It's a very fair question. And I apologize if anybody expected like any kind of body art or strange. I mean,
I think the reason why it's called the lecture performance and is it wasn't actually a term that we gave to these. It was a term that curators and institutions gave. And my kind of my reading of it is that I think that in the same way that music has kind of gone back to this notion of musicians being present and sort of having to actually do concerts for their revenues, I think that there's a need for artists to be present increasingly for institutions. And it's not an artist talk because I, for example, we never call any of our books catalogs. And none of those books that you saw, we don't ever talk about our work in the books. No, we don't even allow anybody to write about us in the books because for us, that's the equivalent of kind of insider trading in the art world. It's basically like what I do is I would sort of ask Gabriel, a respected curator, to write about us, and he makes us look good, and we make him look good, and sort of it's basically would be illegal in most kind of industries.
It's how our industry thrives.
It's how the art world is run. In the lecture performance, I think that, yeah, we don't call them talks because they're not about our work, really. They're about the subject matter, the research. They're much closer to the books in that sense. And I think the reason why institutions gave the word performance is that they're afraid that audiences wouldn't come for a lecture. I think that people are afraid that lecture sounds boring. And I understand because, to be honest, I think that there's a need for a correction in art in the same way that the financial industry had a correction, mm-hmm. in a sense that I go to a lot of lectures and people just read and they're not actually, we were talking about this the other day, they haven't prepared. Mm-hmm. And it's you know, we were agreeing about this, it's super disrespectful to your audience if I get up and go somewhere and take public transport and it's raining and I get there and the person reads, I'll be annoyed because they could just send me the PDF and I'll read it in bed. What's the point of this whole sort of shindig, right? Mm-hmm. Is that you have to, it's hard, but you have to practice and think about it and prepare. And so I think that's why they add performance, because it sounds, and also performance, you guys know better than I do, but I think it's a hot thing for the past decade, right?
And it means different things to different people. When I say performance at the DMA, they think it can only be dance, that we have to have some foreign group perform. And in the art world, you know, it means many different things. I had a kind of nuts and bolts question in relationship to Mola Nasruddin. You were talking about preparation. Where did the research for this go on? And how, I know you said you were introduced to the book at, you know, kind of kismet through this meeting in a bookstore in Baku, but how did you then go and get access to the spreads? Like, how did the kind of nuts and bolts of putting together your publication happen?
Well, this publication is probably the best answer to when people ask why this region, because people always ask me, not only just the public, but our parents ask us, why this region? You know, why don't you just think about your own country? Why don't you do work on Iran and the United States or on Poland? Why do you have to go do work on this region? And it's because this region is in between regions and it sort of falls through the cracks. So it's not China, it's not Russia, it's not the Middle East. And the fact is that we weren't sort of brilliant researchers who found this in a kind of bottom of stacks of a library. Actually, if you go to Baku, you can find this in a bookstore, in Azeri, of course, but in any major bookstore, you'll find Mola Nasruddin. The problem is that people don't go to Baku, and if they do, they go for Eurovision Song Contest or for oil, like they're oil people. So the culture of this region is kind of is overlooked. So we knew something was up. Because again, we could, the publication I should have mentioned, 30% of the illustrations have captions originally that were in Russian or in Persian. Because it sort of shows the polyglot nature, multilingual nature, is that there were many Russian speakers that were reading it, they're not Azeri speakers, there were many Persian speakers. We could kind of make out what it was about, kind of, we couldn't make out entirely. So we knew that it was interesting, and the illustrations actually are not by ethnic Azeris, they were by Germans living in the Caucasus. So there's like Germans, like I guess like equivalent to the Amish, they're German populations that were living in the Caucasus for two or 300 years, I should say, that had no contact with the outside world, essentially. They were sort of almost like, I guess, Amish, or they would speak German, they would not marry outside of their community. And I think that the reason why the illustrations were so on par with other illustrations of the time was because they were probably shared, they were probably getting access to these periodicals, like Nibelungen in Germany at the same time. So.
And again, another sort of like very basic nuts and bolts thing. So Slavs and Tatars is, you know, a name of a collective. And I'm wondering why you decided on the idea of a collective name, like as opposed to the individual identification of you as artists. And then like what's the difference between a collective and individual artist for you? And then the second thing is why that specific name? I guess it speaks a little bit more particularly to the region.
I mean, we deliberately wanted to, we of course are deliberately playing on the kind of absurd connotations of, when you think of Slavs and Tatars, many people think of a horde of people on the horizon coming to rape and pillage. Sort of like Braveheart, you know, just with like higher cheekbones. But that was deliberately, I mean, I think it's very important for us. We obviously don't shy away from stereotypes, and it's important to embrace those things and kind of complicate them as opposed to just act like they don't exist. And for example, we really like the name. We probably think the name is the most interesting thing we've done so far, because what it does is it immediately collapses the really tedious and kind of from very mid-20th century idea of identity politics that we still have. People want to know, are you an Iranian-American artist? Are you a Israeli-French artist? Are you, and it's by choosing a region that has 300 ethnicities, you just blow that to pieces. I mean, we're just as much, and we believe that, we're just as much, I mean, I personally can say I'm just as much Russian as I am Iranian, because I speak Russian better than I speak Persian, or we are, you know, identities are things that, it's only when you accumulate many identities that you can negotiate the difficulties amongst them, right? And that's when it becomes interesting, is that it's not by kind of focusing, obviously, then that's, it's not by saying, oh yes, I am a citizen of the world. That doesn't mean anything. But when you belong to three or four countries that all have problems with each other, like the United States, Russia, or Iran, or like Poland and Israel, or like, you know, then these are when, these are, that's, that, that when you have to negotiate that on a daily basis, that's when things become interesting, I think. So I think the question of the collective, I mean, the reason why it's a difficult question. We're not anonymous. We try to keep our names out of media, for example, and people all inevitably say, oh yes, but I can Google and find out who you are. Of course you can, and it's interesting that in at least the languages that I know, there's no word between anonymity and full transparency. So it seems like there should be somewhere in the middle. Like, what I mean by that is that being anonymous would mean sort of giving this talk behind a screen with a voice scrambler, right? We're not anonymous, that's a very dramatic gesture. But that doesn't mean that we want interest to be in us as people. And it's normal, it's a human instinct. Like, we all suffer from it. You, me, whenever I see something interesting, I wanna know who did it, where are they from, where did they study? But that doesn't actually, I don't believe that really, all it does is it takes away from actually thinking about the work. It becomes a kind of a personalization of things, which is not so interesting. So we try to keep, that's why the collective for us is important more than our identities itself.
And I'm interested to know, so that's how you approach the collective identity of yourselves. What do you see as the intended audience for the material? Do you kind of envision that, and I know this is something we've talked about at the DMA and even in public programming, where the work is not meant to scream out, this is art. That there's a kind of, you have to approach it in a slightly different register, and this is something you guys work at very intentionally. Who would you say is the audience for Slavs and Tatars' work?
I mean, we're very kind of big tent in the sense that it's very important for us that we not our audience be not specifically an art audience. So beyond that, I think that it's important for us that I'm very proud of the fact that, for example, academics like our work. And a lot of academics, and these are academics that often wouldn't, not academics in art history, but say, Middle Eastern studies departments, Eurasian studies, linguists. This for me is very important because these are people who often wouldn't go to a contemporary art show because they're not particularly interested in the problematics. Because a lot of art talks about art. We never talk about art. That's why, I mean, it's not that we're against it, that's just other people do it better. You have to be interested in art to talk about art. It sounds disingenuous, but we're actually not interested in art. Art for us is a platform of investigation, of research, and it's a means to an end. It's not the end in itself. You know, so I think anybody who's, I would say anybody who's a curious person, I would hope would be interested in the work.
Which, at least what I've experienced at the museum, that ends up being the case. You have people here, Slavs and Tatars, they have no idea what that is, or maybe, I'm sure there's a population that knows what that is, but not who you are and what the work is, but there's another population that has no idea what that is. But instead of being turned off by that, and I think it has to do with the approach that you have to the public, people are really drawn in. And I have people coming up to me who won't go to any other shows I put together saying, this is great. I think, I don't know, it speaks maybe to a kind of generosity, but it's very interesting. It's how it's worked out.
Well, I mean, even in our books, for example, the fact that I even mention Benjamin and Bart, for me, this is something that I do reluctantly. We never really mention writers that you often read in art books. And I think the reason why is that I think you always have to put yourself in the audience's perspective is that when I'm reading something, I want to discover names that I don't know. And often in art publications, it's basically people sort of, it's almost like baseball cards, like sort of trading Agamben, Rancière, Derrida, Deleuze, and we've all read this stuff, so why do we need to cite it all the time? I mean, I'd like to know something which I'd never heard of before. And I think it's similarly why we kind of, you know, the work works on different, there's so many different platforms to the work. I often joke that we're like the immigrants of the art world because we kind of, you know that kind of old 70s kind of guy in New York who would say, I have some watches. Oh, you don't like watches? I also have this. So our work is kind of like that because, you know, there's carpets, there's glass sculptures, there's banners, there's publications. It's kind of, there's something for everybody. And that wasn't a calculated decision. It was, I think, again, an acknowledgement of the difference of people, but also within ourselves. That, you know, sometimes you're the introverted type who wants to read a book, well, there's a publication. Somebody else is more formally interested, so maybe they like sculpture. Somebody wants the live element, well, that's why you have the lecture. And I think it's just an acknowledgement, a recognition that, yeah, that there's not one way to look at this work, which is like, there's not this kind of, this is the piece, and if you don't get it, then sort of screw you.
There's a certain degree where your work kind of can go in two simultaneous directions that seem kind of opposite in a way. Like even when you're saying like, do you want this or do you want this? There's an aspect to the work that seems to be about sort of fulfilling something that isn't present. Like for instance, say like Dallas audience's knowledge about Azarias, for instance. You know, sort of a kind of recuperative history to sort of bring something back that may not have been present within sort of standard education practices and all that. But then there's also this other element, which is, and that's a kind of generous gesture, like, here, I will give something that you don't have. But then on the other hand, there's a kind of implicit critique that exists as well, like whether that's the way that language has a relationship to nationalism and empire, right? Like the kind of heavy hand of the ruler who will bring down a certain kind of linguistic tool in order to engage with power over one's people, even in terms of the gender politics that you're referring to. And so like in some ways you're referring to other critiques, but to some degree the work itself could become a kind of critique, right? Like a critique against a particular culture that it's being shown in. So I guess I'm wondering how you negotiate between those two things, right? Something that's about sort of just giving a history, sort of showing something that isn't present, and also something that's slightly more negative in terms of critique.
Well, I mean, this idea of the kind of the fulfilling a, I think that's an interesting way to put it because a lot of times there's been a kind of pedagogical turn, right, in art. And I object to this idea of pedagogy because it assumes that we know something and you don't. Sure. Which actually, that's why I kind of emphasize the reading group is that because we're like a reading group, we actually, we're not specialists of the region. And it would be ridiculous to say you're a specialist of a region so large, but also I think that the generosity comes from the very fact that we devoted ourselves to something which we don't know. We didn't know about this region. Again, we didn't look at things which we knew. If I had looked at things which I knew, I would look at, again, France, Russia, and the United States, let's say, or Iran, but we looked beyond that, and I think that that's why, like a reading group, I think that's that generosity comes from the idea that we're basically embarking on a kind of series of investigations, and we're happy for people to come along and sort of share that with us, or kind of come along for the ride. But there's really not a kind of, and I think that's why it doesn't lecture, it doesn't talk at you. It's okay. It doesn't really talk at you like the phone,
like that.
but it talks with you, like the phone. In terms of critique, I think that it's super important, and it's not cool and it's not hip to do so or to say so, but I think it's important to commemorate at the same time as critique. Mm-hmm. I think there's a Western idea of critique which is objective. I mean, reading this Kapuscinski autobiography, the journalist. And this kind of, there's this idea that to critique something, you have to be objective, like sort of clinical, you have to have no opinion on it, and you have this idea that you can be kind of completely removed from the subject matter. I think that for us, critique has to be, you have to be emotionally involved to critique it, which means you have to kind of, I like this idea of you have to kind of elevate something on a pedestal and stab it in the back at the same time. So you have to kind of, you have to acknowledge the, I mean, whether it's things like modernity, whether it's things like language politics, we don't have a position on the fact that Turkish was changed to Latin. It's super complex. I can't say it was great. I can't say it was a disaster. It was a catastrophic success, as they could call it. So I think that this idea of critique has to be done in a very generous, actually, while Shaki was, we were at a talk of his in Sharjah, in Dubai, actually, and he said, the Egyptian artist, and he said the best way to critique a text is not to, he's talking about the Cabaret Crusades, is not to kind of find all the different historiographical interpretations and give voice to all of them, but he said the best way to critique a text is to completely and utterly be faithful to it, almost like bear hug. So which is, again, the opposite notion of critique. Instead of being removed, you kind of squeeze something so hard that you critique it by almost loving it too much. And I think that's a really much more interesting, more poetic approach to critique, you know?
And along the lines of critique, I mean, the Mola, your publication and the original the mode of critique is satire. And satire is this really interesting way of dealing with very difficult topics, but also, especially in the original, it seems like it's very political in nature, and also trying to kind of maybe enact change. And you, as a group, also use and utilize satire in a lot of your work. Is there ever a kind of that intent to enact change through satire, or is satire more of a way to let people's guard down and then bring them into new ideas?
I think the latter. I think that, satire and humor for us is incredibly important because, yeah, it is a way to disarm people. And to, when you're dealing with such complex subject matter and such sort of polemical subject matter, you have to defuse the situation to a certain extent or seduce. And for us, the kind of humor, it's not just, again, it's a sense of generosity. I really respect humor. I mean, it's like there's something very beautiful about making one laugh, but again, not make somebody laugh by pointing at something and making fun of it. Like this did a little bit too often. That's why we were conflicted, because it's kind of poking fun. Look at how backwards, look at this. And actually, there's another form of humor, which is much more the kind of the generous form of humor, which you're laughing amongst ourselves, I mean, kind of about ourselves, which I think is more interesting. And I think that, yeah, I mean, the question of change, that's, I don't think either of us, anybody in sort of Kasha, myself, really believes that change happens. It has to happen from within, sort of from inside out. I don't really believe that change can be, can come from outside or from up top, really.
just as a quick follow-up to that, do you ever worry that, and I completely agree with you, the kind of laughing at ourselves is very cathartic. Do you ever worry that in a given audience or where when this work goes out into the world that it is read in the opposite, where they're laughing at you or they feel you're laughing at a specific group or topic or moment or culture?
We don't worry about it, but we do consider if there's any kind of, I mean, I think in the developments of the projects, I mean, basically what we do, I mean, you, Gabriel, know this, but I guess it kind of maybe helps to understand how we work on a project is that we essentially have a kind of three-year cycle. We'll choose a topic, a subject matter, like language politics. We'll do a two-pronged approach to research, sort of academic research, sort of bibliographies, JSTOR, sort of on PDFs, and as well as kind of field research going to the place. And then once we know what we have to think about what we want to bring to the table, right? What are we bringing to the table that scores of academics and linguists like yourself haven't already done? And once we know that, then that's really where we start to think about the question of how we give form to those ideas. That's when we kind of question whether it'll be properly, whether it's sensitive, essentially. And at that sort of, but that's only, you know, that's still almost months or if not a year away from the actual kind of production of the work. So, no, we don't really concern ourselves that, I guess, that much with that question. But, I mean, Noah and I were talking about, just coming back to this embracing your antithesis, I was saying that I came a bit earlier because I wanted to visit the Bush Library, and I couldn't, it was the first time I couldn't embrace my antithesis. I couldn't bring myself to go through the, I mean, I went, it was the first time in my life, Kasia was like, yeah, we're gonna visit and we're about to pay, and then I saw the plan of the library and what sort of, how the different exhibitions are organized, and I thought, I don't think I can deal with this right now, like on a nice Saturday right before a lecture. I just, and I couldn't do it, and I was a bit disappointed in myself. Because I think it's important to deal with those things you disagree with fundamentally. Mm-hmm. And we get a lot of flack because we get a lot of flack for kind of putting our foot in the shit, as we say, in various situations, for doing an exhibition in Israel a couple years ago against the BDS movement. Why do you work in Israel? We get flack for being in Manifesta, which was boycotted recently for Russia's politics in the Ukraine or its anti-gay laws. We're going to be doing the first exhibition on Saadiyat Island in Abu Dhabi, which is, you know, the Gulf labor issue and for NYU Abu Dhabi. But we don't do it naively, obviously. But I think that there needs to be, we believe that people are born yes or no people, you know, like the French are obviously born no people, like the Russians. But, no, I'm just kidding. But I think that there has to be a way of engaging with difficult subject matter that doesn't include withdrawal and boycott. Maybe by, the Russians and the Germans have this great term, danyet, which means yes, no. And I think the Germans, I don't speak German, but I've heard they have yain, which means yes, no, ja and nein. And there must be a way of saying yes and no at the same time by basically kind of engaging with those things, again, that you have proper criticism of, but that doesn't mean that you disengage. No, it's tough, and we're gonna have the knives out for us in March, I think.
maybe somewhat related to this, a number of your works in the past have dealt with the question of revolution, and I know the other day, for the press preview of the DMA exhibition, there are these Mayakovsky drawings, which are very much associated with the Russian Revolution, or the Bolshevik Revolution, and a kind of, in a similar way, this kind of sort of refusal of an old society and pointing towards a new one, but also dealing with 1979, the revolution in Iran, mm-hmm. And 1989 is a kind of sort of the other bracket of 1917, of kind of a revolution that was the end of the Soviet Union. I guess I'm wondering how you think of this notion of revolution, because in terms of artists that deal with politics, sometimes there's like a kind of aestheticization of revolution. There's a sort of deep belief in the artwork acting as a kind of agitprop towards revolution or sort of pointing towards a certain kind of change. Even if it is a boycott against something, it's also a kind of pointing towards a certain kind of change or revolution. And I guess I'm wondering, I mean, you don't avoid revolution because you're literally quoting from it to some degree. So I'm wondering how you're thinking about these revolutionary moments.
I mentioned that we get a lot of flack from certain corners of the art world, and one of that is, in fact, how we deal with political subject matter. And I think that some people have to take issue with the fact that we deal with serious subject matter in a playful manner, right? And that there's a kind of, there's some people who believe that if you deal with serious subject matter, the work has to be serious, it has to be dour, it has to be self-serious, and we don't believe that at all. In fact, again, Mola Nasruddin or anybody who's familiar with Russian history knows that the most interesting forms of, or even kind of revolutionary forms of critique have often happened through humor or satire, sort of indirect forms. But revolution, I think that, you know, what we're really interested in revolution is, I would say, is trying to understand the immaterial, the almost the metaphysical or the spiritual energy that surrounds revolutions. And what I mean by that is, I think if you look at all the successful civil disobedience movements of the 20th century, whether it's the civil rights movement with Martin Luther King, whether it's Gandhi's nonviolence, whether it's the Polish churches, Catholic churches' role in Solidarność in 89, I would argue that you can't find a successful example of civil disobedience where faith didn't play a very important role. And yet, all the artists that you just met, that we were thinking of, would never agree to that. They would argue that faith is reactionary, that faith is for those uneducated masses, and that we are somehow enlightened, modern people who are secularized. We don't believe that. We don't believe, when I say that we're anti-modernists, we don't believe that all of a sudden thousands of years of human history have been nullified by the Industrial Revolution and the 20th century. That somehow there's a new man. The Russians believed in Homo Sovieticus. I mean, I guess Americans also, we believe in this kind of idea of homo, whatever you want to call him, liberalist, or, you know, free markets, no taxes. We kind of believe that we have some copyright over a formula that nobody else has figured out, and somehow, you know, it works, and obviously it doesn't. But we just, I think that, you know, faith obviously is more complex in the States, but I would argue that the countries in Europe, which are the most interesting for us at the moment, are those countries where these issues are still being debated, like Turkey, like Poland, where they haven't put to rest these issues of faith and the role of faith in public life, or the role of sort of reform movements, whereas the countries like France and Germany, who seem to have resolved it, I don't believe that's the case. I think they're just pushing it under the carpet. I don't believe that all of a sudden the French in 100 years have become completely, complete sort of atheist. I just don't believe it, because of course the laws and the values are still Judeo-Christian. It's nonsense to even think that, I think.
And along those lines, I'm not saying art is the new faith, but in terms of social practice, do you see art as a viable opportunity for civil disobedience? Can it, can it have the same power that you were just talking about?
I don't know if it could have the same power as civil disobedience. I said our favorite audiences are under 10. I meant it. But I don't know about civil disobedience, but I do think that it's a matter of urgency, that art, if it's going to be the new faith, if museums are going to be the new cathedrals, then we have to regain the transformative power that art had. And I think that, you know, when I hear like Chris, when I think it's Nick Sirota or Chris Durkan on the Tate, saying that museums are now, they occupy the role that libraries occupied in the 19th century, places of sort of entertainment and education, which is great, but I think we're at risk of losing the meditative, transformative element of art. And that's why I'm a big fan of the Manil, for example, because I think the Manil was founded on that principle of art as transformation. And I think it's hard. I mean, I think that it's hard for us, because when you're dealing with so much subject matter, it's hard to kind of, how do you strike a balance? How do you have strike an emotional, numinous kind of spiritual chord with somebody, and yet when you have so much content, right? They're almost in tension with each other. But the most successful pieces of art, I think, are those that take you elsewhere, not just in another country, but another kind of energy, another world, essentially, another universe.
Is that a good time to open it up to the audience if anyone has questions or comments?
How many people have seen the show at the DMA?
Oh, that's good.
Okay, so that's your homework.
Summer homework.
Any questions?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for a beautiful performance. and I, you know, just a quick comment about some of the poor scholars who have to lead in a lecture. It's a tradition. Try convincing CAA that it's a panel. You know, art historians will not read the paper, and I don't think they will read. But that's you're clearly, from everything that you've described and from what I know about your work, you don't deal with the sort of, you know, popular mainstream, what is accepted in the mainstream. But I was particularly intrigued by the comment that you made about censorship. You know, clearly this is not an acceptable, popular sort of, you know, way of thinking that to self-censor is an okay thing and you may sometimes have to do it, right? But for those of us who work in different mm-hmm. regions of the world, we know that we have to. How do you deal with that in the art world? I mean, in the academic sort of side, we kind of have an understanding of that. But I always come to clash. As a matter of fact, I sat on the Doha debate panel thing, which in the simple terms was pro versus against censorship, and I was with the against. No, with the pro censorship, but actually because they present the question as censorship brings the art down or something ridiculous that, you know, has no nuance in it. And I lost, of course, clearly, because everyone in the audience thought that there should be no censorship, you know, we have to have the freedom and so on and so forth. How do you deal with that in the art world, in the different places of the world? How do you explain that? How is that received? I'm curious to hear a little bit more about that.
That's, to be honest, I mean, the question of censorship is, I think, again, it's probably a naivety on the behalf of those who believe that no censorship exists. And again, you know, I see it, the art world is ready to pile on to anything happening in the Gulf or Russia, because they say, because it comes from a position, which is funny, because we're, art is considered to be sort of artists and art world. People pride themselves on being very progressive, open-minded people, and yet often it feels like they're waiting for an excuse to reinforce the stereotypes. Oh, look at the Middle Eastern countries. When Sharjah happened, I don't know if you're familiar with what happened in Sharjah 3 years ago.
I'll explain a little bit.
I should explain
yeah.
it? I can maybe, we're going to show it. essentially, a pavilion was one of the pavilions of the biennial was censored, we were actually right in between that pavilion and the Shia mosque, and the pavilion next to us had t-shirts with phrases from the Algerian, the GLA, right? And it was basically phrases that were used during violence against civilians, rapes, sort of, and phrases that incorporated sort of blasphemous.
The civilians who were abused.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And incorporated blasphemous sayings, sort of blasphemous sort of invocations of Allah, of God, but while they're being raped or beaten, these were recorded statements. They were put onto mannequins, like shop mannequins, in a public courtyard, in a very sensitive area of the world. And this was where children are playing, and this was censored. Now, this would be censored in most corners of the world, even in sort of quote unquote liberal societies like France or Spain or the United States, if you had an open public square, sort of with very violent sort of statements against Jesus or Mary or such, it wouldn't last many days, basically. But as soon as that happened, the art world kind of issued a petition, and I think that there were two things. One is the director was fired unceremoniously, which was a definitely valid and legitimate concern, but the censorship notion was, again, kind of, it's almost like it's a resurgent kind of prejudice that comes out, and I think that We proposed several things that, I mean, projects that we would propose for the MoMA. We just know that when you do a project in MoMA, there's no point in being we're not interested in being inflammatory and provocative. And again, I think that the idea of sort of inflammatory rhetoric or provocation or scandal is, for me, an old way of doing politics. It's a way of speaking at people. It's a way of beating them over the head and saying, look what you don't know, this is what you should know. It's speaking from a position of power to others, or knowledge to sort of ignorance. And I don't think it's more complex than that. I think that, I mean, and if you work in places like the Middle East, as you know, and Russia, if you want to do work, you have to find ways around it. And again, the most interesting artworks or cultural products of the past 20, 30 years from these regions, whether it's Kiarostami's films in Iran, whether it's Kapuscinski's journalism in Poland under communist Poland, it's actually where the constraints are the strictest that you often find the most interesting work. If everything is quote unquote wide open, which it isn't ever, you don't often find the most interesting work. I don't know. I can't comment on the propaganda machine of Russia is we could talk about that for a long time, but also similar forms of, let's say, media. I mean, what we receive here in the United States of news about the Middle East, for example, is not propaganda, but it's hugely biased, right? And Russians have the same capacity as we do in America to go on the internet and to read other sources of news, whether they do so or not. Just like here, most people don't go and look for news outside of the major news channels or the major news websites of the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. Very few people in the States, I would say, read the news from the English language news from the Middle East on the Middle East, usually. But to answer your question about the antithesis, I can just give you a personal kind of example, which is, you know, when you're raised in the United States, in some ways, represents the other extreme of Russia's, right, this kind of spectrum of the individualism. In America, you are the consumer, individual as a consumer almost. Like you have all the rights, the consumer is always right, you can become president, everything is possible. It's all about you, especially if you're the child of immigrants, right? Is it your parents came, there's a narrative that parents came here to give you a better life, you can reach the highest levels of power, look at Barack Obama, you can study the best universities, it's all about you, which is beautiful. But it's also it's one extreme, because the European model would say, well, it's a little bit more about society as well, not just about you. And the Russians would say, well, it's about the state, unfortunately. And as a child of immigrants who grew up in Texas, which is probably the kind of you or individualism on steroids, to be in Russia where every single day is a reminder that you don't matter. You can disappear, nobody's gonna come look for you, you're not gonna be on a milk carton, you don't matter. The windows start above your head. You can't even look outside of them. Every sort of touch point in Russia is a reminder that you as an individual are insignificant. Now, I would not want to raise my children in that society. I don't think that's a healthy society. But it's very important, as somebody who grew up in this, sort of was marinated in these juices, to be marinated a little bit, to kind of be challenged with what that means. Because I think it's always about finding a kind of a happy medium. Each person finds their own happy medium where you are on that spectrum. I'm not a communist who believes in sort of totalitarianism, but I'm not a libertarian who believes that I want to do whatever I want and everybody can go to hell. And I think that's that's a difficult thing to kind of not embrace, but to engage with on a daily basis. And I think that, you know, by doing those things, you learn more about sort of your own position on these things. You know, the most, even as artists, we had a six-page critique in a major art publication where we were sort of taken apart and destroyed over six pages, which I would argue you don't really find very often in art criticism anymore. and I was really annoyed by this article. But now, 2 years later, it was actually probably the best feedback, unintentionally or intentionally, because it forced us to kind of understand where we stand on the situation. That's what criticism is about. That's why we don't allow people to write about us in our books, because we want them to actually, you know, real criticism happens when there's a little bit of a firewall. You know, we didn't share questions before. You know, that's like Noah and I sitting down and saying, okay, so what are you going to ask me? And you know, that's what's the point? You know, we're not gaming the system. You only lose yourself by gaming the system.
Any other questions?
In our own publications.
In your own publications.
No, we would love for people to write about us in their publications.
That was curious.
Because, as you know, the dynamics is in the arts, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is like you do a catalog for a show, for an exhibition, you have a certain budget, and you choose how you want that catalog to be composed. So we're essentially the commissioners of that catalog. So for me to commission you, you're not gonna, as the kind of the proverb says, you're not gonna come to my house and sort of complain about dinner when I cook for you, right? So,
yeah.
Of course, I think it's a good question, and I think I'm glad you raised that, because we have shown several of those as on platforms where people can sit on them and engage with them in another way. And I think that's why they're rugs, essentially, is that they work on walls, because I don't know if what's really interesting is in the former sort of in Eastern Europe and Poland and Russia, you often put Persian rugs on walls, sort of behind beds, which was interesting because, again, it's what is under the feet in the Middle East is considered to be something kind of to be contemplated on the wall. But we like the fact that it can be used sort of both ways. And I think that, you know, for us, the most interesting work happens when the audience doesn't know what to do with the work. Meaning that, you know, when you have something that can be sat on, people don't know, well, can I sit on it, can I not? Because again, art, usually you can't sit on art. And you don't know, is it fiction what they're telling? Is it true history? Is it sacred? Is it profane? Is it a joke? Is it serious? And that's not only the audience doesn't know, but we don't know sometimes. We know that for us the most rewarding work is when 2 or 3 years down the line we still don't understand the work, which is interesting, right? Because you've been thinking about it for a couple of years and it still escapes you. Thank you for coming.
I'm a part of this conversation. I grew up in Venezuela, I opened the American school. So most of the kids spoke several languages. And one of the things that I still remember to this day was I had a great history teacher. And we took an event in history, this was in world history, and we had to find sources written in the US, in English, in Latin America, in Spanish, and from a different source. And you instantly learned that everybody's telling you something. And a lot of this is bringing all of that back to mind, but it was a very interesting lesson to have in high school.
You're lucky to have it so early.
Yeah.
Diffuse, I think, I mean, definitely not inflame, I don't know, maybe diffuse, I think that it's, if you want, we, I mean, this is our perspective on this, and of course everybody is entitled to their own, but we don't believe that you ever should deal with subject matter frontally, meaning that if you want, when we decided, like Noah mentioned this 79-89, when we decided to tell the story of Iran today, post-2009, the presidential elections, we decided to tell it through the perspective of Poland in the 1980s. When we decided to talk about syncretism in Islam, we did it through the fruits of the region. When we decided to talk about language politics, we did it through Mayakovsky. And I think it's important to go from, if you want to go from point A to point B, it's interesting if you go through point C to point B. And that's where that engagement with the other or other subject matters, and it's kind of like intellectual acrobatics also, right? It kind of forces you to stretch your own thoughts and your own ideas.
Okay, well thank you so much. Thank you
to Sass
and Tatars, to Gabriel.
Thank you, Noah.
And to all of you.